I'll ask one of my colleagues to just introduce you, and then you can take things further from there.
Sure. Yeah. Thank you.
Good afternoon, everyone. I, Dr. Ronika Sharma, Associate Professor and Head UG Department, welcome you all to the post-lunch session four. It's a great pleasure for me to introduce our next speaker, who is Professor Perry Denbrook. He has been a professor in education and learning sciences at Wageningen University and Research Netherlands, and chair of the group with the same name, Education and Learning Sciences, that is ELS. His research interests lie in the field of educational innovation, rich and innovative learning environments, teaching, learning, and professional development. He has also conducted many studies on teacher in secondary education. For example, on topics such as classroom management, recently, teaching with information communication technologies has become a topic of interest. Professor Perry is also chair of 4TEU, Center for Engineering Education, a center that initiates, supports, and studies courses and curricular innovations at the four universities of technology in the Netherlands and disseminates insights to practitioners and policymakers and support staff at higher education institutes. Not standing much between you and the learned speaker, I request you, Professor Perry, to kindly share your reflections on the theme University Teaching During the COVID-19 Period, report from a longitudinal monitoring study. Thank you all.
Thank you for this nice introduction. Well, welcome from my side from the Netherlands. It's an honor to have this keynote at your conference. And I will now try to share my screen in the hope that you will be able to see my PowerPoint. And now I hope that you, yeah, I hope that you see the PowerPoint okay.
Yeah, we do that.
Yeah, nice. Okay. So today I will be sharing with you findings, a lot of empirical findings, and a few, you could say, reflections or lessons learned from a longitudinal monitoring study that we did at our university. And we also did it with this 4TU Center. So I will refer briefly to that later in my talk. And the study came to be that when the COVID-19 period started in the Netherlands, that was in March 2020, I was immediately approached by the rector of my university, who asked, can you monitor what will be happening with education, with students, with the teachers? Because this is a unique situation. We have to teach online now. It's basically one big educational experiment, you could say, one big innovation. And he asked me, what support do you need? Do you need access to information? And so, well, I will say a little bit about it later, but basically, I got all the collaboration and cooperation that I needed. And so today, I will share some of the findings of the study that we've been doing the past 2 years. And actually, some information is even from a couple of weeks ago when we did the last measurements. But before that, of course, first have to acknowledge my team who did a lot of work. So we did the study with a team of five people, and of course, with a lot of collaboration from the university. So there was a support department where we who helped us in collecting data on assessment, on student satisfaction information, and so on, and also helped us to distribute surveys and helped us setting up in organizing interviews with people. So the team is really important. I have shared the slides of this presentation also with Dr. Gupta. So those of you interested, I think, can on the left or right obtain the slides. And of course, I can always send to people interested. Apart from that, you can also find information on this project on the website of the 4TU Center for Engineering Education. If you have some time somewhere, it might be really interesting to go to that website. There is a specific page on this project, but the website also contains information on about 300 other innovations at the four universities of technology in the Netherlands. It's freely accessible. It contains a lot of practical information, research reports. So just so you know, it's there. So what will I present with you today? First, I will explain a little bit on the information that we collected. Then I will show you some trends in teacher and student well-being that we've been monitoring during this period. I will also show some beliefs that students and teachers had about online education or blended education, but also show some other information. And I will already kind of disclose a little bit that there is a difference between beliefs and what you see in practice, but more about that later. I hope to show you some trends in what happened at our university in terms of teaching methods, the way people organize their courses. And then we looked also at differences between teachers and between students and how they dealt with experiences in the COVID-19 period. We created profiles based on the information. So I also hope to share with you the profiles we found, and it might be interesting while listening if you kind of recognize those types also in your own context. And of course, I will end with some lessons learned and recommendations. And I hope then that there's also some time left for you to engage in discussion and maybe ask me questions. I already indicated a little bit. We really had a wealth of data. We created surveys for students and teachers, collecting information on really a number of things. Which we could broadly distribute. Okay, it's being recorded. Are you still seeing slides? Yeah, okay, sorry. So we created surveys which we distributed, but we also got access to information collected during exams, online exams. We got access to the database of the university on student satisfaction with courses, so really hundreds of courses. The exam results themselves, so we could monitor trends in the grades of the students. And of course, we compare that to pre-corona periods. And then of course, the data, the numbers tell you something, but it's also good to get a more qualitative view. So we also conducted interviews and workshops with teachers. We went in depth with a number of courses, and we also had access to course information. So really a lot of data. I will not present information on all of these sources, but just so you know that we really had all the means available, which was kind of nice to really monitor what was going on with teaching and learning in the COVID-19 period. Kind of the framework we followed is that we use the courses and the adjustment to the courses kind of as the starting context. So we asked teachers and students a lot of information about that and looked at data. And then of course we asked about their experiences and we looked at the learning outcomes. And of course we hope that by looking at one, you see also trends happening in the other parts. A very rough framework, but that's also because we had to create the study on the spot, basically didn't have a long time to prepare it. So you could say it's in that sense also a practice.
You know, international author ka chal raha hai, hum bhul gaye, late kar diye, join kar diye. International author ka presentation chal raha hai.
Someone is can maybe thank you. So the first results, teacher well-being. We monitored that during 3 years. And what you see here is, so the first bar is really at the start of the COVID-19 period. You could say it's the emergency period, the moment of sudden change. then a year later, we were kind of, we were in a lockdown, but there were also some things possible on campus. And of course, teachers were already known a bit to the situation of online teaching. And the third one is actually from 6 weeks ago. There was a period when all the measures in the Netherlands were relieved. So we teaching on campus was allowed, but many teachers were still in a phase of transition, you could say. So they did some things online and some things on campus. There were also still a lot of students who had COVID, so couldn't come. So it was kind of a transition period, you could say. And what you see here is basically that, well, workload is high. This is on a scale from 1 to 5, actually. So teachers consistently report a high workload. Especially in motivation, you see that in the beginning, they were very eager to create the online education, but they really had a dip in the second year. And there is a little bounce back, you could say, in the recent period. What you do see, and that's interesting, is that stress in the beginning was very high, of course, because people had to create home situations, really to do everything in a rush. Then it seemed they got used a bit to it, so the stress was a bit lower. But now, recently, you see an increase in stress again, and you may wonder what's going on there. What we think is that the stress caused recently is mainly by the constant changes people have to adapt to in terms of the measures, and perhaps also a lack of a long-term outlook. So people really wonder, so will we return to normal now, or will there be some kind of new blend? What's happening? So that's, I think, one of the ideas behind this new increase in teacher stress. How is that for students? Again, we collected information in the same periods. Well, and you see workload similar to the teachers is more or less stable and reasonably high. You see really that motivation during the online first 2 years was not good with students. They were really not motivated. But now you see a bounce back. So they can come to campus more. There's more physical contact between students. They bounce back. And the same, you see that also reflected in the student stress. So you see it's high in the real online period, in the period where they weren't allowed to come. And you see a sudden decrease now in the last period. So it's interesting to see that for the students, there's already a recovery, you could say, in well-being, but for the teachers, there's still continued stress. And of course, it's interesting to kind of ask yourself, how is that in our situation? Do we also see this bounce back or not yet? We asked teachers and students about if they felt supported by training, by the online infrastructure of the university, and if they felt capable to teach or learn, and what these results show is basically that they were, very satisfied about the way our university organized things. There were a lot of trainings. They really handled the online websites and the Teams and all the other tools very well. And also people had the idea that they were able to provide courses online, but with stress, as you know from the previous slides. And students also felt capable to do online education, though not always with that much motivation. So you could say the context created was as good as it could be. Now the beliefs. Here you see some bars about student beliefs about the outcomes of online education. And you could say the red and the yellow or orange is kind of a negative view. And the green and the blue is a positive view, and the grays is a neutral view. And you see, and this is actually, I took this from the middle measurement, so the 21 measurement, but it was really the same for 2020 and 2022. What you see here is that when you ask students, they believe that in the online situation, collaborative learning is not very effective. Feedback of teachers is not as good as it could be. Their engagement is not that positive. Motivation, similar to previous slides, not very positive. And they also think that how they perform is less than or not that good as it was pre-online, you could say. And just remember that it's negative. So, of course, we also ask teachers. Again, you see a very similar picture occurring. So the same items, but you again here see the same trend. It's even a bit more negative than with the students. So teachers definitely also think when you teach online, the outcomes are worse, the motivation is worse, the engagement and participation is worse, and the interaction and the feedback is worse. Now, of course, the interesting question is that also visible in the actual outcomes and the way people teach and the student satisfaction about this? So the belief is it's not that positive. So what we did is we looked actually at the course satisfaction data and at the course grades and also at the percentage of students not passing the course. Now the grades in the Netherlands, you have a grade between 1 and 10. 10 is the maximum grade, it's extremely excellent. You need a 6 or more to pass a course. And you see here displayed the average grade in the 4 years before COVID-19. And then the last one, the bold one, is the first COVID year. And actually, we also have data from the past 2 years, but the trend is similar to 2019, 2020. And what you see is that the average grade is not worse, so the performance is not worse. And note that the course goals were not adapted. So sometimes the learning process was adapted, but and the assessment might have been adapted to fit an online situation, but the level of the course wasn't changed, the goals weren't changed. And what you see is actually even a small increase in performance. And we interviewed students about this and they said, well, yes, because of the lockdowns, we couldn't do all kinds of side jobs, so we had to stay at home. So we had more time for studying. So they had a good explanation for that. And now, of course, the interesting thing will be, now COVID is more or less gone and the side jobs are coming back again. Would that reflect also lower grades again? So, but you see, although they believe, both students and teachers, that the grades, the performance is worse, it's the reverse is actually the case. You do see a small increase in people not passing the course. So, and that has to do with some people indeed being ill, especially in the practical courses, there were some delays. So internships couldn't be done, excursions couldn't be done. Some of the practicals had to be postponed. So that's reflecting that. But again, we had expected a much higher number there. It's only a little bit higher. And when you look at the course satisfaction data, I just had the last year before COVID-19 and the first year in, you see that when you ask the students about how the course was organized, how satisfied they were with the teacher, if they liked the teaching methods, etc., it's stable. And we continue to monitor this. It remains stable. Might also say something maybe about the instruments themselves, but apparently this sudden transition didn't change that much. So there's an interesting difference between the beliefs of the outcomes and the actual outcomes themselves. Then we had a lot of things asked about changes in teaching methods, and I'm only showing you some slides, just to give you some main trends and ideas. But we ask about a variety of teaching methods, varieties of tools used, how often. What we were particularly interested in is to know how much did you keep as it was when you had to transition to the online situation? How much did you have to replace? So, for example, face-to-face lecture to an online lecture, or an a physical practical into an online practical. And how much did you actually revise? And the revising is interesting because it means you're not just simply moving things from on campus to online, but you're really transforming the teaching learning process. So you it's not replacing, you really aim to add, enrich, maybe transform the whole situation. And what you see is here for two teaching methods, trends in the first 2 years, and the third year, actually, the trends continue. So what you see is that for lectures, you see that people first try to maintain as much as possible or replace. And the further you come in this period, the more they really revise. So they either stop with the lectures or they embed the lectures in a completely different setup. For example, a flipped classroom ID. And with the group work, the practicals and the excursions, you see a similar trend. There, it was in the beginning either canceled because there couldn't be a practical organized or replace it online. And there again, clever ways were come up, sometimes with at-home practicals, sometimes with practicals in smaller groups or combinations with online practice and then just one or two. So there you see again a trend towards revising. And yeah, that's interesting to see. What we wonder now is what will happen now post-COVID. So will people revise back to the old, or will they now maintain what they revised? And actually we are currently conducting interviews with teachers. So I don't have the numbers and the ideas about that yet, but yeah, it will be interesting to see what happens. More qualitative information, we also asked teachers about, students about their opinion on teaching methods. And the main teaching methods, we were wondering, so do you prefer the online version or the blended or the on-campus variant? And it's interesting to see when you ask teachers about the lectures and the interaction, and we interviewed quite a number of people, you get kind of a mixed, ambiguous response. So about half the teachers say, I really like this online teaching. I really like this this blended teaching. It really gives me additional opportunities, or I can win time. So that's the statements you see displayed here. But at the same time, you see that teachers say, well, if you ask me, I really miss or prefer the live lecturing, or I miss the physical, the on-campus feedback from students. Online is not the same. I really need live interaction for the learning objectives to have the students achieve them. So yeah, you really see this double orientation. On the one hand, yes, it's nice, all this online teaching. On the other hand, we really don't want it. I will get back to this a little bit later, because you also see that reflected more or less in the differences between teachers in profiles. Students, interestingly, you see a similar thing. You would think there will be a massive preference for on-campus teaching and on-campus interaction, but you really see, for example, with lectures, it's going both ways. And the same for individual work at home versus group work on campus, it goes both ways. So it depends on who you ask. And apparently, students see the preferences or the options for both. On the one hand, this is of course quite difficult for the management of the university, because there's certainly not one overarching trend. So it's really part up to the teacher, maybe part up to the program. So when I kind of summarize all of this, so what you see is on the one hand, an emergency period where people had to transfer to online teaching, learned a lot with new tools and teaching methods. And that happened reasonably well, but of course caused some stress. It wasn't always liked. It wasn't always believed that it really helped. But the performance didn't go down. You see that teachers really transformed their teaching later on in the process. And some of these changes already people indicate they would like to maintain. They really do, that's the question, but they indicate they want to maintain those. So nice to see that you go from replacing to revising, which is actually what you hope. So it comes more underpinned, it's really, people really reflect on what is the added value of online teaching and learning. But you also see a lot of differences. People evaluate the teaching and learning activities differently depending on who you ask and even in what course you ask. I talked a little bit about differences already, and what we did is we decided, because there were quite a lot of differences between teachers, we decided to conduct a hierarchical cluster analysis, and that's an analysis method where you where you look at a set of variables. In this case, you see well-being variables displayed here, and you see belief variables displayed, and you create groups of teachers with a score or a profile that is as much alike within a group and optimally different between groups. Now you see it's not very radical, the differences, but you see some lines intersect here and there. And that means that there are both, you could say, quantitative differences in well-being and in beliefs between teachers, but also some more, you could say more fundamental differences. And of course, this is very abstract. We also decided to create labels for each of these profiles and a description, and you see that displayed here. So in the end, we found four profiles, and again, the profiles are rather stable, at least in the first 2 years. We have to do the analysis for the recent year, but in the first 2 years, you see more or less the same profiles occur and also a more or less similar distribution. So the first group of people, it's actually the largest group, are people that are critical towards the online transition, but they are eager to learn. So they are negative, they have negative beliefs about online education, not too positive about support and how they handle online education themselves, but they learn from their experiences, use the services, and they also indicate they learn. Then you have a second group, also quite large, that is, you could say, positive, but with stress. So they see the advantages of online education, they embrace the new situation, you could say. They also think they are able to do it, they like the support they receive, but it comes with a price, you could say. So they go for it, but it costs them a lot of effort and stress. Then you have a group about one-fifth of the teachers that you could call them reluctant. So they have negative views about online education. They have negative beliefs. They're also not too happy with the support. It's more or less that they consider, well, it's needed, but I really don't think it's good. They also, on the same hand, do not experience much stress, do not use a lot of these services, and they do not learn a lot from their own experience. So it's basically, you could say, it's a survival group. They transform because they have to, because it's the situation. But if it wasn't necessary, they wouldn't do it. And then you have a small group who's really optimistic. They grab everything they can. They're very positive. But also, they like it. So it doesn't cause too much stress for them. And of course, it might be that these are the people who are already a bit more you could say, online people before the transition. So it's likely that that also explains why they have a low use of services. Now, we looked at, do these profiles matter for some of the other things we've measured? So do they tell us a little bit about the difference in support? And I already told you a little bit about that. And the perception, so yes. What we found was that the profiles that were, you could say, the positive stressed and the optimistic ones, so the second and the third, the second and the fourth one, they were a bit more positive about this. We did find also differences in gender distribution. So now I have to look. There were more women in the positive but stressed profile and in the optimistic easygoing profile, and there were a little bit more males in the, you could say, the reluctant profile and the what was the other one, the critical but eager to learn profile. So it seemed as if the women were a little bit more positively oriented and a little bit more open to it. But that's overall, of course, there are huge individual differences. And then finally, we looked at the teaching role people had, and there we also find differences. So you have, at our university, you have two types of teachers. You have the coordinator, that's, you could say, the main teacher of a course. They also organize all the assessment, all the guest lectures, they do the organizing and a lot of the teaching. And then you have the lecturers, basically people that take part in the assessment and in the lecturing, but don't do a lot of the organizing. And maybe as you would have expected, the coordinators were found more in the positive and stressed and the reluctant profiles. So the profiles with higher stress, you saw more coordinators relatively. Yeah, I think that's somehow logical, because these people not only have to transition in teaching, but they also have to deal with all the changes in the organization. We didn't find any differences in age. So young, old people, inexperienced in teaching, that is, not per se in online. We didn't find differences. I'm looking in time. Okay, I'm doing well, I think, because I am nearing already the end. Similar thing we did with the student data. So again, we looked at well-being data and attitude data, and we did this cluster analysis. And with students, we did not find four profiles, but three profiles. And you see already the differences between the three profiles are a little bit more distinct. And again, you see lines crossing and sometimes parallel. So it means that sometimes there's a gradual difference and sometimes there's a more fundamental difference. And here you see the descriptions of the three student profiles. We are still figuring out good labels. So any help on that is appreciated. So there are three profiles. You see the first profile, and you see a smiley with a thumb up. Basically, you could say that's the positive student profile. So that's the students are motivated. They are not negative. They are also not positive about online learning outcomes. They experience some stress, but not too much. They don't mind to learn online on their own every now and then, and they are quite positive. So that's almost a quarter of the students. A third of the students is, you see a little bit of a scared smiley there. So their motivation is low to study online. They also have a bit worry if they can study online well. They don't like learning online. They experience a lot of stress. They like a lot of on-campus learning, if you ask them. They're more or less neutral about what the university organizes. So it's a rather negative profile, you could say, and they're even a bit worried. Then you have the third profile. That's almost half of the students. They're neutral about motivation. They think they can study online. they don't have very positive beliefs about online learning, but they are stressed. So it's you could say that it's especially they're a little bit in between the other two, and it's the major group. And our expectation, based on some of the slides that I really showed you in the beginning with the trends of the 3 years, is that but like I said, we still have to do the analysis for the last year, is that we will see an increase in profile one and a decrease in profile two. And we wonder about profile three. It might also decrease, depends on how positive they really are. So again, we looked at, do their profiles matter? And here you see, interestingly, while you do see a lot of differences in beliefs and motivation and well-being, when we looked at all kinds of background variables, these profiles, there was no difference in distribution. So no gender difference, no age, not nationality. If they were in the first year of their study or later, if they were in a bachelor or master, that all didn't matter. So you could say these three profiles are very general across all types of students. And that's kind of interesting. And that was a little bit different than with the teachers. So I'm about to wrap up. So what does this learn us? What do all this what does all this data tell you and us? Well, first of all, that there are huge differences between the teachers and the students. And it's a difference in beliefs, it's a difference in motivation, but it's also a difference in behavior to some degree. So there are quite some differences there. And when you look also at how people view support and how they use support, for the university, it's very important to realize these differences. So you will achieve some of your staff, some of your teachers quite easily, but others much less. Some might go more to colleagues. So I think for university, it's very important that there is a differentiated approach. And I think not just during the COVID-19, but also for the future. Interesting is this difference between beliefs and actual outcomes. I think it's of course also has to do with the fact that life changed completely as a whole, that people were maybe negative about having to be at home and doing everything online. But it is not the case, at least not according to our data, that that the performance and the interactions really go down a lot in quality. In fact, we even saw some reversed patterns. So addressing these beliefs and discussing them with teachers and maybe showing beliefs versus actual data and discuss about this, I think is important because there are differences and it might also change the beliefs perhaps a little bit. And it's important because I think we all learn a lot now, but it would really be a pity if we really referred back to as it were, as if nothing happened and we have learned nothing. I really think we should take along with us the positive new experience that we have. Another thing we learned from the data is this emergency replacement to more conscious revising, you could say. And again, I think it's very good that it happens. It will be interesting to see if there will be another reversing in the current period. But again, I think this calls for different policy of universities and different support. Let's see. It seems as if my... Do you see the next slide now? Oh. Ah, there. This is my last slide. So of course, not all was sunshine. there were some teaching methods that were really vulnerable. So practicals, exams, and excursions. And during the COVID-19 period, there were no real good available solutions for that. So I think it's important for universities and for education researchers to really look for maybe interesting blends or alternatives in case, in the future we run into a new lockdown or period. But even if not, then I can imagine that creating new tools and methods to blend in technology in practicals and in excursions, that will really help. So I know at our university, for example, there are now tools being created for teachers for excursions that students can collect data with their mobile phones and so on. And that really can be used in a nice way. There is some experimenting with virtual and augmented reality more than before the COVID-19 period. And that's not to say that we need to replace everything, but I really think that we should prevent that those methods in the future again become victim to being canceled. We do worry a lot about the continued increase increased high level in workload and stress. And like I said, I think there is a clear for more predictable change in the future, if possible, but at least a more stable and long-oriented policy and not go from lockdown to lockdown and change to change. And finally, I didn't tell you a lot about that, but what we did during this project is every time we collected data, we gave back those data to all the teachers. So we organized webinars, we organized a lot of sessions where we also presented these data. And that really helped. It helped teachers, it helped the program directors, it helped the deans to already adapt on the spot and to sometimes also to maybe not that things changed a lot, but that people were more confident or that their worries were a little bit decreased, for example, when it came to, for example, the beliefs about the outcomes, that it wasn't as dramatic as they saw. So now I stop sharing. And that was at least the input from my side. So I hope now that people have questions for me or maybe points to discuss.
Well, Professor Perry, it was indeed an exhaustive study. The first question which comes in our mind is, can we replicate your research study in Indian settings? And further, we can do a comparative analysis for the same?
I think that's possible. What I didn't tell you about is that some of the surveys that we created, they're actually all in English because we have a very international staff, that we share them, for example, also already with some of the other universities in the Netherlands, and they also start collecting data. And of course, I think what apart from the specific questionnaires or maybe interview, that it would help if we at least focus on similar topics. So the well-being, for example, I really think that well-being is not a topic that, I mean, I think there is now an increased attention for well-being due to this transition and this online education. With our, just before this talk, we were discussing the climate. I think a lot of students and teachers are also worried about that. So I think well-being in general is something we should monitor as universities more, both with teachers and students, in relation to education and maybe more in general, and address it in our education as well. So one of the policy things I see happening in the Netherlands now is that we really get skill scores for students, but also studies on well-being and how to improve well-being or how to maybe increase resilience more or deal with uncertainty. So, I think that's also topics. Of course, what we already find difficult, and it might be even more difficult when we do an international comparison, is what were exactly the conditions. So I showed you these three measurements, but there were already within Wageningen, there were already quite some differences in the context. So the first one, it was really complete lockdown. The second measurement was kind of some things allowed, but also a lot of things not. And the third one was everything allowed, but not everything already back to normal. A lot of illnesses still. So, and I think apart from measuring the, you could say the factual data, we also need to map carefully what were the conditions or what were the situations we were in. Is that helpful?
Thank you so much. The second question is how to inculcate practical skills among students through online teaching?
Depends a little bit, I think, on the types of skills you're talking about. What we, for example, started doing in Wageningen is that when you look at courses that train a lot of skills, in the past, all the practice and all the assessment was done on campus, physical, etc., observation. What you see now is that the assessment is still on campus, that some practice is on campus, but that, for example, presentation skills or negotiation skills or collaboration skills, there are actually quite nice tools available already that that use video capacity, for example, of the computer, where students, for example, presentation skills, it's called the Skills Academy. That's one of the tools I know. Students can self-record, and the program, apart from that you can view the recording back and so can observe yourself, it also registers, for example, your use of voice, your use of gestures, if you look into the camera or not. So I think virtual and augmented reality and video tools more and more allow also to give feedback. And I think rather from thinking in a complete replacement, I can imagine that we do a little bit more online practice next to all the practical stuff. And I can imagine a similar thing happening with some of the practicals in engineering courses. Of course, it cannot always be done, but also in terms of when you think of safety or in terms of using materials, sustainability, I really think we can gain a lot. And like I said, like excursions, again, you can have some tools. There are more and more 3D videos made, so you could think of maybe more and less intensive blends next to just everything on location.
Well, thank you. In your study, you have reflected that 20% of the teachers showed their reluctant behavior towards online teaching. Mm-hmm. But the big question is how to motivate those teachers.
Yeah, that's a good question. I think there are a number of things that can help there. So one is, and I think that motivates all teachers, if there is a clear outlook to the future. So if there is a really clear view, what do we do online and why do we need to do that? What's the advantage? That's one thing. I think using a variety of support. So if you know that some people will not come to trainings that you offer, then it means you will have to actively visit some of these teachers, perhaps, or use approach colleagues more to get into touch with them. And a third thing that I think can really help is at our university, I think it's similar in other countries and other universities, teachers have to obtain something like a qualification to teach at the university. So they have to show certain basic capacities, but also to grow in their tenure track or in position, they have to also show that they innovate, that they, that they become better teachers. And there, I think it helps if there are advanced opportunities for teachers to engage in innovation, a wider variety. So not just offering courses. We have an innovation fund now in Wageningen. We have teacher design teams that collaboratively do. So sometimes it's they also don't want it because they feel isolated or they think, well, it works, but not in my course or not for my topic. But then working with other teachers, they suddenly see, hey, these teachers struggle with the same things. So it's really a combination, I think. And then still there will be a group that will be slower and at some point maybe not willing. But that's also the case with on-campus teaching.
Thank you so much. There are much to say about it, but the last thing which I want to ask you is, could we consider majority of teachers' negative beliefs about online education as reflection of their lower level of openness to experience trait of personality? Because you're talking for the well-being. So I think to be openness to the new things, it's again a trait of our personality. Could be one of the reasons for that?
I certainly think that personality can play a role. I think people that have a more open mindset or have a more are more open to uncertainty, they deal differently with the COVID-19 situation and any change in that matter than people that are a little bit more in the personality more prone to stability, maybe to structure. So I think, yeah, personality plays a role. I also think the unique situation in this case played a role. The fact that it's not just education that had to transform, but basically having children at home while you teach, because the schools are also closed, not being able to go outside or to family. So of course that also played a role, I think. And like I said, I think prior experience also plays a big role. So if you already had some experience and you know which are the positive affordances of certain online methods, you're probably less anxious to use them. You probably transition quicker. So, but personality certainly is one of the factors, yes.
Thank you so much for clearing all the query. Thank you, sir.
You're welcome. Yeah. I have the chat open, so I don't know if there's any people online with a question.
Most of the questions have been taken by us here.
Yeah.
And so we would like to, thank you for connecting with us for this conference and sharing your lovely keynote address. I'm sure that much food for thought has been given to us, because the interplay of sector profiles of the teachers and the students that you shared were, providing a very great insight. And also, one key factor was that teachers always viewed their workload as one of the major factors during COVID-19. I'm sure these some of these aspects would be addressed slowly and gradually as more and more training in ICT is given to teachers and they are more at home with using the online learning management systems and other platforms. So thank you very much from the core of our heart for connecting with us, and we hope to connect in future on many such occasions. Great connecting with you, and thanks once again for accepting our invitation to be a keynote presenter at the conference.
Thanks a lot. It was a pleasure. And like I said, feel free to go to the website of the 4TU, approach me. I think the slides will be available. If people are interested in the survey, I'm happy to send them. So yeah, glad to be in touch with you, and hope you all stay well, healthy, and not too warm.